Okay, well, thank you very much, you know, for this opportunity to come here and then to share with you my research about the Christianity in modern China, especially in South China. As Professor Tam mentioned, I just finished a book called The Bible and the Gun, Christianity in South China. I think this lecture is basically based on what I have written, you know, in my book. And I think the area that I'm looking at is this small part of China called Chaozhou, which is actually located at the border between the Guangdong and the Fujian provinces in South China. And I think the period that I'm looking at is from 1860. That was the time of the Second Opium War, when all the Catholic and Protestant missionaries were allowed to go to China to preach Christianity. You know, from 1860 up to 1900. 1900 was the time of the anti-Christian Boxer Rebellion. So I want to look at, you know, what was happening to the Christian movement in China during the 40 years period. Now, the reason I look at this period is, or maybe the reason I choose this region. Now, Chaozhou is a little bit interesting, it's one of the very interesting places in South China, because I think in the late 19th century, it has the largest American Baptist and the English Presbyterian mission fields in the entire country. And also during that 40 years period, the missionary, the American Baptist and the English Presbyterians, they report large numbers of the Christian conversion in this place. And the other thing is, in Chaozhou, when you look at the map, it is so far away from Beijing, the capital city, and it is also quite far away from Canton and Hong Kong. Canton at that time, it was the center of the regional government of Guangdong Province. So when you look at Chaozhou, it is actually quite marginal, because it is far away from the central and local government, and the government did not have much control over this region. So there was a long history of collective violence. There were many incidents of fightings between different villages over the control of land and water. So I think my study is to look at the relationship between Christian conversion and the local violence. And I want to find out, you know, what is the relationship between these two phenomena, and if there's a connection, and how I'm going to explain this. Now, in this study, I think there are three main arguments. The first argument is, you know, whenever we talk about the Christian movement in China, I think we must understand one thing. The center of Christianity in China is always in the countryside, not in the city. Most of the Christian actually came from the villages, not from the city. So we must understand the rural origin of the Chinese Christian movement. The second point, whenever we look at the Christian expansion, we must understand the Christian expansion within the context of the local society, especially the local conflicts. Because in South China during that time, you know, there were so many incidents of conflicts over the control of land and water. So we have to see how the local villages actually use the Christian missionaries and also the church connection to empower themselves and also to make themselves much more stronger in the local politics. So there was a strong political dimension behind the Christian movement. And the last point, because most of these Christians actually came from a rich traditional backgrounds, you know, they came from all these villages and lineages. So to them, whenever they join the church, they never break away from their traditional lifestyle or traditional custom. Whenever possible, they always integrate all these traditional ideas and traditional lifestyle into their Christian organization. And what I find interesting is, I think in this part of South China, whenever we look at all this religious conversion, all these religious conversions never take place as an individual conversion. All of them take place as a family conversion, village conversion, or sometime the entire lineage conversion. So here we are talking about, you know, several hundred people suddenly join the church, you know, at the same time. Okay, so here we're talking about a very unusual phenomenon of the mass conversion in the late 19th century. Now, I think tonight I would like to divide my lecture into three parts. Maybe in the first part, I'm going to, you know, define the term Christian conversion, and also to tell you something about, you know, the historical development of Chaozhou in the 19th century. In the second part of my presentation, I'm going to tell you something about, you know, the numbers of conversion you know, how many Chinese actually became Christian during that time, and also how did they become Christian? What kind of network helped them to find? What kind of network helped them to discover this, you know, Christian religion? And in the last lecture, in the last section, I'm going to use two Christian villages to illustrate some of my arguments. In fact, I personally spent, you know, several months living in those villages, so I can tell you lots of, you know, insider story. And of course, I think after my presentation, you can ask me whatever you want to know. Okay, first of all, about religious conversion. Now, whenever we use the term conversion, we have to be very careful because it is a Western terminology. In the late 19th century, whenever the missionary used the term conversion, they are talking about a person who suddenly discovered Jesus Christ as their savior. And once they become Christian, they decided to join the church and they remain an active member of the church. And what is more important is, you know, once they become Christian, they have to give away, well, they basically have to break away from their traditional lifestyle. For example, ancestral worship and all this feng shui practice in the local society. Now, that is the 19th century missionary attitudes towards conversion. But when I talk to the local people, I discovered that they have a totally different attitude when they talk about religious conversion, whenever they talk about Christianity. Now, in the local language, the local people in Chaozhou, whenever they refer to themselves as a Christian, they said, "I am a worshipper of Jesus Christ," or "I am a worshipper of Virgin Mary." Okay? And whenever they talk about their religion, they never said, "I believe in Christianity," or "I believe in Buddhism." They only said, "I worship the Christian God. I worship the Buddha." So when I deconstruct the local languages, I discover one thing. I think for the local people, religious is always about ritual practices. It's not about what kind of ideas, what kind of doctrines that you subscribe to. So to them, the ritual practice is the most important element. Now, something about this region, Chaozhou. How many of you have been to there? No? Okay, I think Chaozhou is actually quite a marginal area in China during that time, and even till nowadays, because when you look at its location, it is at the border of two southern China provinces, the Fujian and Guangdong, and it is also far away from the central government and also the local government. So for a long time, this region, the Chaozhou region, is very much, I would say, semi-independent, you know, from the central government and from the local government. That means the government did not have much control. That also means, you know, there was a serious problem of local banditry, local violence, and certainly people are not going to pay taxes to the local government. So here we're talking about an extremely competitive and violent environment in 19th century China. Now, in Chaozhou, since the 17th century, you know, since the 17th century, large numbers of the local people actually left the region, and then they went to Southeast Asia. You know, they just, you know, go to Southeast Asia to look for work, and most of them actually went to a country called Thailand nowadays. So they went to Thailand and they worked there, and hopefully, you know, by the time they are about to retire, they would just go home and then just to spend the rest of their life back at their home villages. So here we're talking about this area has long been exposed to the outside world, especially to Southeast Asia. And what is interesting is, in the late 17th century and early 18th century, during that time, Christianity was banned by the Manchu government. So for those Catholic and Protestant missionary, if they want to go to China, you know, they will not be allowed it. So they have to work among the Chinese in Southeast Asia, or maybe among the Chinese in Macau, at that time a Portuguese colony. Now, in 1830, a small number of the American Baptist missionaries arrive in Thailand, and then they work among some of these Chaozhou immigrants workers. And what happened is, you know, some of these Baptist missionary convert a small numbers of the immigrant workers. And what happened is, after they become converted, the missionary encouraged them to go back to their home village in South China and help to spread the Christian religion. So what happened is, before the Opium War in 1840, you already have a small numbers of the Chaozhou Christians already returned to their home villages to establish churches. So the most in, So before the creations of what we call the unequal treaty system, the Protestant Christianity already found its way from Southeast Asia to South China, and they basically rely on all these Chinese migration networks. Now, at the beginning, the missionaries have to rely on the Chinese immigrants to get their job done. But what happened is, you know, 20 years later, in 1860, we have the Second Opium War. And in this war, the French and the British government, they basically attacked China and then forced China to open up, you know, to this to the Western power. Now, what happened after the Second Opium War is China signed a treaty, and China also allowed all these Catholic and Protestant missionary to go into the country, and they also allowed them to travel to the countryside to buy land, to buy properties for the building of churches. So, the 1860 is a very significant year in the Chinese history, because after that year, the missionary can basically just, you know, do everything by themselves. They no longer have to rely on the Chinese immigrant or even the Chinese Christian to do the work for them. Now, let me just show you, you know, one of the pictures here. Here is the map, you know, that show you, you know, how the American Baptist missionary actually rely on this migration network from Thailand and then make their way into Chaozhou, the South China region. And here is a map. This is actually a very old picture that I found. That's a very old picture that I found in one of the American Baptist missionary archives. After the Baptist missionaries, you know, arrive in China, they actually established themselves in the city, in the urban area, because according to the Treaty of Beijing in 1860, the Chinese government actually have to open most of the coastal city for the Western merchant and also the missionary. So the American Baptists and also the English Presbyterian missionaries, they arrive there and then they establish themselves in the local treaty port. And here is the picture of the mission headquarters belong to the American Baptists. Now the problem is, I think once all these missionaries arrive in China, the Chinese are not very happy to see them, especially the Chinese official, the Chinese scholar, and all these local leaders in the city and also in the market town. Because to all these local leaders, they saw the missionary as a threat to their traditional authority. They saw that, you know, the missionary coming in trying to compete with them, you know, for the local power, for the local resources. So for all this, so most of the local leaders, they basically trying to do everything to stop the missionary from established churches in the city. Now what happened is, you know, since the missionary did not get very good responses, you know, from the people in the urban area, the only thing they can do is basically to move to the countryside and try to convert the people, the peasants, the farmers in the countryside. So that means the further you move away from the city, the better. The interesting thing is in Chaozhou during that time, because the government did not have much control over the region, and during that time, in 1860 to 1870s, the Chinese government also trying to expand into the countryside by launching a series of military campaign. The reason is they discover one serious problem. Most of the local villages have their own army, okay? And certainly they never pay taxes for many, many generations. So basically the Chinese government, what they really want to do is to go to the countryside and try to reestablish the imperial control over the rural area, over the interior. Now, whenever they launch all this military campaign, some of the local community decided, you know, in order to protect themselves, they decided they're going to join the American Baptist and English Presbyterian mission to become Christian. And they even asked all these foreigners to come to their villages to establish churches. Because once their churches is established, that means these local people are connected with all these outsiders. And that means if the Chinese government would like to attack them, the Chinese government have to think of, you know, some kind of diplomatic consequences, because you are also destroying, you know, the foreign presence, the British and the American presence in the villages. So what happened is, you know, throughout the 1870s, you actually have large numbers of conversion. Most of these people, especially those people who came from all these hostile villages, they joined the Baptist church, they joined the Presbyterian church, some of them even joined the Catholic church as well. So the situation you have here is, you know, throughout the 1860s and throughout the 1870s, there was a strong political consideration behind the Christian movement. For those Chinese who joined the church, I think their main purpose is basically to use the churches to protect themselves and also, you know, to safeguard their community against the government threat, especially the military attack from the state. So during that time, we actually see the Chinese Christian churches actually develop as what we call a protective organization. That means the church will basically protect the local interests of their own members, especially the Chinese members in the countryside. Now, how many people actually joined the church, you know, throughout that late 19th century? From my reading of the church membership record, I discovered that there was actually quite large numbers. Now here are some of the figures I discovered, you know, from my reading of the Baptist and also the Presbyterian church membership record. What I discovered is I think most of the conversion actually took place, you know, during the 1870s period. That was the time of the military campaign, and also in the early 1890s. The reason in early 1890s is because I think the local military commander, he just passed away. So basically the people decided, you know, they would like to, you know, join the church again, basically just to go to the church to establish themselves and also to use the church to challenge the local authority. So during that, you know, during the 1870s, we actually have as many as 800 people join the Baptist church and also 500 people join the Presbyterians. And also by the end of the 19th century, we have almost 1,500 people in the Presbyterian church and also almost 2,000 people in the Baptist church. And when we look at the numbers of the village churches, there were as many as 200 village congregations that were being established. Now, when I use the term village congregation, it means more than just a church building in the Chinese countryside. Whenever I use the term village congregations, I mean basically the entire villages, they just joined the church. Okay, here we're talking about several hundred people suddenly become Christians. Now, the other interesting thing is, if we are going to look at the gender structure of the church, we actually notice a very interesting phenomenon. In the past, historians used to think that, you know, Christianity is more appealing to women than men. But in this case, in the case of Chaozhou, it's actually the other way around. I actually discovered there are more men than women in the church. And in fact, when we look at the percentage, I think the male church member, men, actually make up as high as 60% of the church members, and the women only make up 40%. And I start to ask myself, you know, why were there so many men, you know, inside the church and so few women? When I start to read all these missionary reports and missionary correspondence, and also when I talk to some of the elderly Christian ladies in the villages, I discover three things. For many women, especially the Chinese women in the villages, it is actually very hard for them to become a church member, basically for two reasons. First, most of them were illiterate. They can't read. So that means, you know, they are not able to acquire a sufficient amount of knowledge of the Christianity. Because in the late 19th century, if you want to become a Christian, you need to pass through many religious tests. So for these women, because of their illiteracy, you know, they are not able to acquire sufficient amounts of the Christian knowledge to get them past all these religious exams. And the other reason, at the beginning of the Christian movement, all the religious preaching were done by men, both the male missionaries and also the Chinese evangelists. Now, at that time, it was not very easy for a Chinese woman to go to knock at the door of the missionary and tell him, you know, I would like to learn more about Christianity. It was not considered to be acceptable practice at the villages. So for this woman, they do not have that many opportunities to meet all these, you know, male evangelists. In fact, it was actually until the introductions of what we call the Bible woman, you know. I think when the missionary realized this problem, they introduced a new institution called Bible Woman. They basically just appoint, you know, some of the Chinese women as evangelists and basically send them to travel around the countryside and also ask them basically, you know, to ask this woman to help them to convert the local women in the villages. Now, when we look at the age structure of the Chinese Christian during that time, it's also quite interesting. In the past, we used to think that, you know, the young people are much more open to this Christian message. But in Chaozhou, it is the other way around. When we look at the age structure, 70% of the church member came from the age group, came from the elderly people, people who were over 50 years old. Okay, and the young people only make up 20% of the overall church members. So in Chaozhou, the older you are, the more open you are, you know, to this foreign religion. And I guess, you know, when we look at Chaozhou, when we look at the example here in Chaozhou, there must be some kind of connection between the aging process and also the conversion practice, especially for all these elderly men and women. They may find Christianity to be a very good answer, to be very useful for helping them to overcome this fear of death. Okay, while as for all these young men and young women, death is far away, so they don't care. Now, when we look at the geographical distributions of the Christian movement, I think most of the conversion actually took place in the countryside rather than in the city. And in fact, based on the record I have, I think the churches, especially the mission headquarters in the city, they only have 5% of the overall church population. So the other 95% of the Chinese Baptist and Presbyterian, they are basically spread across the countryside. Okay, so that actually go back to one of the early arguments I have. The center of the Christian movement in 19th century China is always in the countryside and not in the urban area. And the other interesting phenomenon about this Christian movement is when I look at the social identity, you know, the social identity of this Chinese Christian, most of them became Christian as a group, as a family, as a lineage, or as a clan. To them, Christian belief and also their family identity are two things of the same coin. They cannot separate it. Okay, so there was an overlap between the Christian faith and also the Chinese kinship identity. And the other thing is, I think in most of these Christian villages, most of these villages were actually war village. Okay, they were built like a castle, like a fortress. They're surrounded by a wall. And those people who live in the villages, usually they belong to the same family group. Okay, so it's very much a single surname, single lineage, you know, a single lineage community. People who live in the same village, they belong to the same family, the same clan. So what happened is, whenever the leader of the village has become a Christian, he or she will basically take the entire group to the church. So basically, it's always the elderly person who make the decision for you. So Christian conversion has never been an individual decision, individual choice in China. It's always a group decision. It was always a group conversion. Now, let me just give you some example to talk about, you know, some patterns of family conversion in China. And that is basically the second part of my presentation, example of family conversion. Whenever we look at the family conversion in China, I think we must be aware of two main principles. First of all, it was a deliberate policy of the Protestant missionary to convert the entire family to Christianity. I think for all these American Baptists and English Presbyterian, when they arrived in China, they were so impressed by this family structure in China. So they realized if they want to convert the Chinese, they cannot target one or two individuals. If they really want to convert the Chinese, they must target the entire family. So to them, they strongly believe in these ideas of the family conversion. And they also realized that if you really want to make sure Christianity will take root in China, so they want to create what we call a Christianized family, a purely Christian family in China, to make sure the Christian faith will pass down from generation to generation. And in fact, I think the Presbyterian mission even make it as a requirement for the church member. Before you go to baptize, you know, before the baptism, you must have share your religious faith to your family members. If you do not do that, you are not qualified, you know, to be considered to, you know, for baptism. So from the very beginning, the missionary policy always, you know, target, always focus on family conversion. Now the second principle Most of these family conversions basically follow the Confucian ideas of age, gender, and kinship hierarchy. So it is always the leaders of the family who convert the rest of the family to Christianity, or maybe the most well-respected person of the community who convert the most junior one. So they always follow this age, gender, and also the kinship hierarchy. Now, throughout this conversion process, the Chinese Christian parents actually have much influence over their children, and especially their teenage sons and daughters. Now, within the Chinese family structure, most of these children will never consider to be independent from their family before they divide their household property. Okay, even though they got married, they only became adult, but they are not totally independent. It was only when they leave the family household to set up their own family household. That means, you know, they are considered to be totally independent. So before these people, before these children who leave the family, the parents have much influence, has much control over the children. So for those elderly men and women, once they become converted, what they did is they basically get all their children and grandchildren, bring all of them to the church. A good example is in one of the village churches called Mi'o. They have about 150 people, and these 150 church members actually belong to 10 families, 10 local families, and we can see the same patterns of family conversion in some other area of Chaozhou as well. So once the Christian faith became a family identity, we can see all the children, grandchildren, and even the great-grandchildren have to be baptized, because for these children who grow up in a Christian family, conversion was not an individual choice. It was basically a family duty that they cannot avoid. Now, the elderly men have much influence over the conversions of the children, and the same can be said of the women as well. Because in China, and especially in Chaozhou, in rural China, the women actually, they were basically the master or the managers of the household. And they basically took control of the educations of their children and grandchildren as well. So for this Christian, for this woman who were Christian, what they did is they basically took all their the children and their grandchildren to the church. So the missionary always, you know, target the woman, because they believe that once you can get hold of the elderly woman within the community, then you basically get hold of all the children. Okay, so they always target the elderly men and women, and then to use them to convert the junior one, the younger one. So so when we look at these patterns of Christian movement, we actually understand one thing. In China, if you want to go to preach or to spread the Christian ideas, you need to acquire two conditions. You must have the age advantage, you must also have the social seniority. If you don't have the age advantage, if you don't have the social seniority, that means, you know, no one will listen to you. So it's always the older generation who convert the younger one, not the other way around. Now, when Christianity became a family religion and Jesus Christ replaced the old ancestor, and when Jesus Christ become the new family ancestor, most of this Christian family basically just, you know, make their children and grandchildren to join the church. So from the 1860 onward, we actually have many incidents of, you know, family who remain in the church for 3 to 4 generations, even till nowadays. Now, there are advantage and disadvantage about this family conversion. The advantage is, I think the church will always have a regular surprise of church members, because when you convert the older people, after 10 years, you're basically baptizing the younger one. And another 10 years, you're basically, you know, you're baptizing the next generation. So you always had a, you know, regular surprise of church member. The church will grow, you know, steadily. But the problem is, the church often became what I call a family church, a lineage church. That means the church is only open to the people with the same kinship network, with the same kinship identity. So the church are never open to any outsiders. So there's a problem. It became an extremely exclusive family institution or lineage institution. It is not always open to the outsiders. Now, let me now move on to talk about two Christian villages that I went to, and to talk about, you know, some of the experience I have there. Now, in the first Christian villages, is this villages called Yamzhao? The Yamzhao village. Now, the Yamzhao village is actually the largest Presbyterian villages in China. Now, can you recognize the four Chinese characters at the top? Do you know the meaning of the four Chinese characters?
The passage from the stretch to the beginning.
Very close. Yeah, I think the truth or the way is to look for the origin, to search for the origin. It's actually quite funny. I think they got this statement from, you know, some of the Taoist texts, and then they just put it in front of the church, and you can still see that nowadays. Now, I think the Yamzhao Church is actually one of the oldest and also the largest Presbyterian congregation in South China, in Chaozhou. Now, about the Presbyterian movement in Yamzhao, I think the Christian development in these small villages always have to do with one particular family called the Lin family. Now, as early as 1840s, some of the German missionaries were already working among this, you know, among the Lin family. But at the beginning, they didn't find the people very encouraging. You know, they did not have much support. They did not get much conversion. So after a few years, you know, many of these German family left the villages. And at that time, they only got one Christian convert among the Lin family. And 10 years later, 1860s, you know, when China was forced, you know, to open up the entire country to all these Christian missionaries, you got the English Presbyterian missionary who come in, and they first established themselves in the city, which is about 20 miles away from these villages. Now, once the missionary established themselves in the urban area, in the treaty port, that Christian of the Lin family, he decided it is time for him, you know, to take up this leadership position within the Christian area, within the village. So he went to the treaty port and he asked the English Presbyterian missionary to come here to help him to establish a church, and of course to make him as the leader. So that's very important. Now, the English Presbyterian missionary, when they first arrived in Chaozhou, they did not make many converts, you know, in the urban area. You know, they encounter lots of protests. So suddenly one day, these Chinese villagers knock at the door and ask them, you know, come to my village to help me to establish churches. They were so excited, they were so happy. So without thinking twice, so they just run to the villages and just give him lots of money to help him to establish these churches. And what happened is after this, you know, Presbyterian church was established, we actually see the entire Lin family join the church. The entire Lin family joined the church. Here we're talking about almost 100 people. You know, they suddenly joined the church. And what happened is, I think the missionary basically made this Christian, Lin, his name is Lin Qi. They basically make Lin Qi as the local church leader, and they also offer him some kind of, you know, religious training, and to make him as one of the early evangelists in the area. And they also pay for his children's education. And what happened is, you know, his elder son later became a deacon, you know, the leaders of this local congregation. And his second son was ordained as one of the first Presbyterian minister in China. And his third son became a medical doctor working for the mission hospital. And his younger son received an English education, and guess what? He became a businessman in the local area. You know, he would like to become a businessman rather than working for the church. But what you see is, I think this family actually, you know, have a very interesting experience, you know, regarding their conversion. I think to them, the Presbyterian Church actually helped them to acquire all this prestigious status. Before the arrival of the Presbyterian mission, they were just farmers, fishermen, and local merchants. But after the conversion, they actually became church leaders, school teachers, doctors, and even businessmen who work in the treaty port. So the conversion also helped them to acquire some new career options. The conversion also helped them to develop all this, you know, leadership skill, literary skill, and also professional skill that helped them to succeed in late 19th century China. Now, throughout the 19th century, this Presbyterian church actually became the center of the local Christian movement. And from this church, they also established, you know, 5 or 6 different regional branches. And from that time onward, we can actually see, you know, this remote village, this unknown village, actually became one of the center, the heartland of the Presbyterian movement in Chaozhou. Now, I think this church, I think it was built sometime in 1860. And I think in the year of 2000, just 3 years ago, they actually have, I think it's 150th anniversary or something. They had a very big event. And then they basically invite all the local government official, all the overseas Chinese Christian, and also some of the former missionaries to attend the service. So to them, they would like to use the events to demonstrate their connection with the past and also to show off their overseas Chinese connection. So in a way, when you look at this, you know, local Christian community, I think the Lin family still remain dominant in the local religious organization and also in the local politics too. Okay, so I think in this first case of lineage conversion, we can actually see how a small group of Christians, they use conversion as a way to empower themselves and also to make them more stronger and also wealthier in the local area. Now, in the second village, it's what I call, the name is Guxi village. Now, the Guxi village is a typical Chinese war village. It's surrounded by a river, as you can see. It's surrounded by river, and there's also a very big wall, you know, surrounding the villages. So it was very much built like a fortress. Now, in the late 19th century, there were about 1,500 people who lived inside these villages. There were two main surnames. One is the Li, the Li family, and the other is the Yao family. The Yao and the Li, I think they make up the, you know, the village population. Now, before the arrival of the Baptist mission, most of these people, they were what I call a temple worshipper. They basically worship some of the local god and local spirit. And now here are some of the pictures of their shrine and also the pictures of their... here's the pictures of their shrine and also one of the guardian spirit that they worship. So they basically just follow the traditional Chinese Pure Land Buddhist practice. Now, in 1880, the American Baptists actually make their way, you know, into these villages, and then they convert a group of the Li family. Now, in the late 19th century, the Li and Yao are the two dominant surnames. But within the Li, there were also deep division as well. The Li family is divided into the senior Li and the junior Li. And these two groups has been fighting against one another over the controls of water and also many other resources. So the relationship within the Li is not very good. Now, in 1880, the American missionaries arrive and they convert the junior Li, the junior group within the Li family. What happened is, you know, you basically see the entire group of the junior Li, you know, join the Baptist church, and they also help the Baptist missionary to build a chapel inside the village. Now, here is a picture of the division within the villages. You can still see there's a war village, and I think the junior Li basically control the northern area, and the senior Li, they control the eastern part of the village, and the Yao family, they control the western part. And outside the village, you also have some, you know, tenants who came to the village to work for these two big families, the Li and Yao, the Guok and Jing family. Because they were outside, they were just tenants, so they are not allowed to move into the village, so they have to live outside the wall. Now, in 1880, the junior Li became Baptist, and they basically established a church outside the villages. The reason it's because at the beginning they tried to build a church inside the villages, but there were lots of protests from the senior Li and from the Yao, because these two groups, they were basically Buddhists, okay? They were quite unhappy to see Christian churches inside the community because they believed that, you know, that will upset the local feng shui, you know, the cosmological harmony, okay? So because of this reason, they refused to allow the church, you know, to be built inside the community. Now, what happened is after the junior Li become Baptist, 10 years later, we actually see the entire senior elite actually went to the other way. They all became Catholics. They all became Catholics. Now, why? What happened? You know, why one group of the Lee family become Baptist and the other Lee, you know, actually become Catholic? It always have to do with some conflicts between these two groups. In fact, there were two incidents that I discovered, you know, from all this interview. According to some elderly people, they told me that, you know, during the 1880s, once the Baptist Lee, well, you know, once the Baptist Church was established, you know, there was some dispute between the junior Lee and the senior Lee over which ancestor they should worship within the lineage hall. Now, according to the story, the senior Lee, they want to worship the spirit of Old Father. The junior Lee, they would like to worship the spirit of the Old Mom, okay, the Old Mother. So they were arguing which spirit should be worshipped, you know, as a common ancestor. Now, because of the junior Lee, they were much weaker and they were actually fewer in numbers. So what happened is, at the end of the debate, I think the senior Lee basically make the final decision. We are worship the spirit of the Old Mother, Old Father, forget the Old Mom. Now, for the junior Lee, they feel extremely unhappy with this decision. So what happened is, they basically left the Lee family, they basically left the Lee lineages, and they refused to give any money, any donation, and any support to any form of ancestral worship. Okay, so they basically just, you know, move away, you know, from the senior Lee labors, and from that time onward they say, you know, we are going to break away from you, we are no longer friends. Now, once the junior Lee leave the villages, the senior Lee also make a decision, you know, because they are not supporting our ancestral worship, so they have no rights, they have no access to use all the local resources, especially land, water, and also, you know, many other, you know, natural resources in the area. So the tensions were always there. The tensions were there between the junior and the senior Lee. And a couple of years later, 1885, this group, the Jiang settlement, just a one, you know, a small group here, they would like to establish their ancestral hall in their villages. The problem is, you know, when they present this proposal to the local community, the senior Lee was outraged because they think if this tenants, if this worker establish an ancestral hall in the villages, that means they are challenging their authority. Because I think for those people who live inside the villages, they were what they call the early settlers, the early immigrants. But for these people, they are just strangers. They are latecomers. So if the Jiang established an ancestral hall in the villages, I think the senior Lee feel that they were being challenged, you know, by these immigrants. So they refused to allow the Jiang to establish an ancestral hall. Now, what they did is they basically asked the Chinese local official to interfere, to support them, you know, in this local dispute. Now, again, the senior Lee asked their relative, the junior Lee, you know, to share the cost of litigation. Because if you're going to deal with the Chinese official, you need to hire a lawyer. It was expensive. Okay, just like we're here nowadays in the US. So at that time, it was very expensive because you need to hire a lawyer to defend yourself in front of the Chinese official. So the senior Lee basically asked the junior Lee to share the cost of litigation. But I think the junior Lee refused to do that. So no. So basically, you know, tension and conflicts remain. Now, what happened is on a Sunday, some of the government officials actually came to the villages to find out what was going on, you know, what kind of dispute was there between the Jiang and the senior Lee. It was on a Sunday, and they walked past the Baptist church in the north, and some of these Chinese officials, they were very curious about what was going on inside the church building. So they just walk into it and try to find out what is the Christian worship is like. So once they walked into the church building, the Christian service, you know, was going on. The American missionary actually asked the Chinese official to leave the building, basically, you know, because, you know, they are now having this religious ceremony, religious service. The soldiers, you know, should not come in to disrupt this whole service. Now, the senior Lee people, they witnesses the whole event, and they realize if you are a member of a church, that means you have the support of the foreigners. That means the local government official cannot touch you. So because they realized the political power of the foreigners, so the senior Lee decided they should also find a Christian organization to come to the villages to support them. Now they tried to find an English Presbyterian, but the English Presbyterian and the American Baptist, both of them were Protestant. And in fact, they have some kind of agreement. You know, they're not going to invade the other's territory. So the English Presbyterian refused. And at that time, the French Catholics arrived in South China. And what happened is, I think the senior Lee actually went to see a French Catholic priest and asked the French Catholic priest, you know, please come to the villages. We are going to give you the land. We also give you the money to build a Catholic church. And at the end, the French Catholic mission decided, okay, that is a great offer, you know, from the local community. So they came in and they actually established one of the largest Catholic chapels in the region. Now this is actually a new Catholic church that they rebuilt. But I think that was the tower. I think that was the tower that they built in the late 19th century. At that time, it was the tallest building in the area. And I think in the first picture, I think that was the new chapel that they built, I think, in 1997. But you can still see, you know, the scale, because I think it was actually one of the largest buildings in the area. And they also built a Catholic church outside the villages because it is too big. They can't really put the whole things inside the walled village. So they basically just, you know, use some of the land south of the villages and then convert it into a Catholic chapels. Now, what happened is right now, you have the Catholic and the Baptist, you know, they coexist side by side, one in the north and the other one in the south. Sometimes in 1896 to 1898, these two religious groups basically, you know, came into a fight. They had a big fight. The reason is because I think the Catholic would like to expel the Baptists, you know, from the villages, and the Baptists refused to go. So what happened is, you know, they can't reach any compromise, so they decided let's have a fight. And at the end of the fight, the leader of the Catholic Church, he was arrested. He was basically taken by the Baptists as a hostage. And then the Baptists basically just, you know, took the guy and basically just, you know, hand over the Catholic leader to the Chinese official. And from that time onward, when the Chinese official interfered, these two local congregations, they appealed to their own mission for help. The Baptists go to the American Baptist mission and also the American diplomatic agents in South China. The Catholic go to see the French Catholic mission and also to ask the French diplomatic agents in China to interfere. So at the beginning, it was basically a local incident. But once all these foreigners interfere, it became a diplomatic crisis. It involved China, France, and also America, the United States. So it became a diplomatic crisis, and it took many, many years, you know, for this, you know, free power to negotiate a solution over, you know, this tiny little incident. And I was very surprised. I was actually very surprised, you know, some of these French and also the American missionaries, they even write to their government back in Washington and Palace, and they also write to their ambassador in Beijing to ask them to put pressure on the Chinese government to make sure the Chinese central government in Beijing will put pressure on the local government to punish the other side. So you can actually see, you know, how they actually try to use the foreign diplomatic channel to manipulate the way that the Chinese official trying to reach a decision. Now, at the end, I think the French actually have much more power over the Chinese official. So at the end, I think the local official, you know, they have to make a decision that is favorable to the French. So they release the Chinese Catholic and they basically ask the Baptist, you know, just, you know, to behave yourself, you know, no more conflict, no more violence. And after the incident, the tensions died down for a while, but still, the Baptist and also the Catholic movement, you know, remain in the region. And I think for the junior Lee, the Baptist religion actually became, you know, their family identity. And the same can be said of the senior Lee as well. Now, what is interesting is when we look at this conflict, only these two parts were involved. But what happened to the other? I think the Yao family, surprisingly, the Yao family basically stay away, you know, from this religious violence. I think there may be two explanations. One is, I think for the Yao family, I think the members within the Yao family, they are very much living in harmony with one another. So they don't have that kind of, you know, resource conflicts as what we see within the Li. And the other thing is, I think for the Yao family, they realized these religious conflicts were basically part of the family or the lineage conflicts within the Li. So they don't want to get themselves involved. And certainly they don't want to get themselves involved with the Chinese official and the foreigners. So they basically remain neutral throughout the entire incident. And also because in the eyes of the Yao, whenever they talk about the Baptist and the Catholic, they say, this is the Li, the junior Li's religion, this is the senior Li religion. Because they do not have the same kinship identity, that's why they, they don't want to become Christian. So you can actually see the Christian faith and the kinship identity, again, they are the two sides of the same coin. They cannot be separated. And certainly, I think for the people within the Guxi area, for the senior and also the junior Li community, they continue to see these two churches, you know, serving their own benefits, serving their own advantages. Now, maybe I think at this stage, I think I should conclude, and then maybe if you've got any question, then I'm quite happy to answer your questions. Maybe just to conclude, you know, what I said here. I think in this research, I think when I look at the Christian development, the Christian expansion in the Chaozhou area, I noticed, you know, there were some characteristics. I think the first characteristic is, you know, the large numbers of group conversion, you know, the group conversion, the mass conversion. Here, religious conversion always took place as a family, as a lineage decisions. It was never an individual decision. And the second thing, although the missionaries, you know, try to come to China to establish all these religious institutions, but at the end, it is always these local Chinese villagers who take the step, who take the initiative to build all these churches and to build all this Christian organization in the countryside. So the native Christian, they actually play a very important role in advancing the Christian movement. And the last point is about the overlap of the Chinese kinship identity and the Christian faith. I think to many of these, you know, Chinese villages, to them, the Christian conversion was basically, you know, part of, to them, the Christian conversion, it was basically, you know, part of a tactics that they use to hold their own family, to hold their community together, especially in times of crisis. And certainly, I think in this marginal area, in this marginal environment, I think whenever we talk about conversion, on the one hand, we have to recognize the importance of all these, you know, desires for religious salvation. There was certainly a strong religious element, but at the same time, we also have to pay attention to all this, you know, political and even economic incentive. Because I think to the first generations of the Christian, whenever they talk about the church, they are talking about the foreign power, the Western power, and how they can actually use the foreign power to empower themselves, to make them remain dominant and powerful in the local politics. So I think I should stop here, and I'm quite happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you.
What is the level of violence?
Yeah, I'm glad that you asked this question. Yeah, yes, I think that they actually used gun at the time. Yeah, they actually used gun and cannons. No, they actually make it by themselves. Yeah, they actually make it by themselves. In fact, there's something I discovered I never noticed until I went to the villages. And also until I read some of the local newspaper. I think in China, well, in the old days, you know, you think, you know, you get all these, you know, weapons, you know, from the Westerners. But in fact, the local people, they know how to make their own. And in fact, there were quite a few families in the prefectural city. They were very famous for making all these, you know, local gun, local cannons. And there were big market for that. Because basically all these villages, they were war villages, they need to protect themselves. And one thing though, when you see this Catholic tower, do you see this cross? Now the reason they built such a high tower is whenever there's any fighting between the Baptist and the Catholic can always get to the top of the tower and to watch all, to see through the war, and they can fire, yeah, they can just shoot at their Baptist opponents, yeah. So there was a really, you know, there was a strategic function when they built this tower, yeah.
I was wondering, when you say that these villages were all basically individual family clans,
yeah,
how broad a family are we talking about? Because
yeah, that's a good question.
You know, you have a problem with inbreeding and the church
of course
would discourage that, I think.
Nowadays, but not at the time. I think for this family, I think here we're talking about, you know, several hundred, you know, several. Certainly, I think in the first case, the Yamzhou case, they have. I think the Lin family actually had about, you know, several hundred people, but I think within the second case, the Guxi case, I think the Li had about, you know, 500. I think the junior had maybe 100. The senior maybe have 400. Yeah. So here we're talking about very big,
very distant cousins.
Yeah, very distant cousin. Yeah. And certainly, I think the church, they're quite happy to use that kind of family networks for their religious purposes. Yeah.
What this religious missionaries? What is this this spiritual component that we talk about, the Western concept?
Yeah.
Is there such a concept in those times, then, back then, or what about now, and what about now?
Yeah, certainly there was a strong spiritual components within the Christian message, and certainly I think the missionary talk about that in their writing, in their annual report. But what I noticed on the ground is the missionary preach their own versions of the Christian message, but the local people did not pick up whatever the missionary preach. And I think there are two incidents. Well, first of all, is on the whole subject of ancestor worship. I think the Baptists, the English Presbyterian, and even the Catholic are totally against that, you know, in the late 19th century and early 20th century. But still, the local Christian, they carry on the same ancestral practice on their own. What they did is they basically just have their own so-called the Christian ancestral ceremony. Yeah, I think they developed their own, but certainly they did that all behind the back of the missionary. They never tell them.
What about now?
They continue to do that now.
So in that sense, that Christianity, as they understand it now, or even back then, is different than what is considered Christianity in the West here.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, I think that there's one question here. Here we're talking about how the Chinese understand the Christianity. Certainly, I think at the village level, you cannot expect the Chinese will adopt 100% the European form of Christianity. There are always some kind of, you know, modification in this process of religious interaction. And within the Chinese context, one thing I notice is when you talk about the ancestral worship, they know it is a very sensitive subject. I think the Chinese and also the missionary know it's an extremely sensitive subject. So what they did is, they basically try to avoid dealing with it. And what happened is, I think to some of these Chinese Christians, they try to find a religious justification for doing that, because they have been doing that for many, many generations. And the other thing is, for the junior Li and also the senior Li family, and also for the Lin family, once they become converted, they actually create their own ancestor. They basically refer to the first convert of the family as their ancestor, and then they rewrite their own family genealogy, and then they incorporate this Christian ancestor into their religious ceremony.
So it becomes that the ancestor that they worship now is the one that first converted.
Yeah, the first converted, not the one, or maybe not some other distant ancestor that they used to.
Sound very much like Abraham.
Yeah, in a way, yeah. I think, yeah, in a way, yes. I think they, so in a way, I think they're extremely creative.
Very pragmatic in a sense.
Yeah, you can say that. But I still think, you know, they're extremely creative in adopting, you know, certain Christian rituals, you know, into their own, you know, lifestyle. Now, the other problem, the other thing that actually touched on this question is about the whole practice of polygamy. Yeah. It was also a very sensitive subject at that time. And in fact, I think for the English Presbyterian, most of the church leaders, including the Lin, the leaders of the Lin family and also the Li family, most of these men do have, you know, many, many wives. So the problem is, but at the beginning, the missionary cannot afford to offend this local Christian leader. So they basically keep the whole thing, they keep everything quiet. Okay, just, you know, pretend nothing happened. But when they come to the second and third generation, they start to make it, you know, make some kind of regulation within the church. They said, if you really want to become a church leader, you know, you must not practice polygamy. And they also start to propagate these ideas of, you know, the Western concept of the marriage and family among the second and third generation.
What about Christianity? Does this, the modern Christianity, especially since 1980, from 1990, I think that a lot of Western missionaries under disguise into China, and probably propagating this Christianity in big cities. How is that different than what is compared to a village?
Yeah, that's a good point. I think for this, what we call the New Christian Missionary Movement, when China was opening, I think in late 70s and for the 80s and 90s, I think there are many Westerners and also many overseas Chinese who returned to China to propagate Christianity as well. But I think they target a totally different audience. They basically target the urban population and those people who are never exposed to the Christian message. But I think to this, they are basically the old Christian. I call them old Christian. To them, there were not much interactions in the 80s. And in fact, I think the old Christian feel a little bit more skeptical of this new guy. Why are they coming in? Why, you know, who give them the authority to teach us about Christianity? We have been, we were Christian for two or three generations.
By name.
Yeah. No, not by name. What do you mean by name?
Well, by name in the sense that not according to what we understand here in America or in Western society, what Christianity is.
Okay, yeah.
They already co-opted with their so-called.
Of course, yeah, but I think the same everywhere. I think you see the same phenomenon everywhere. People would basically just incorporate Christianity into
American Indians.
Exactly. So I think for this local, for this what I call the old Christian, they actually see their own practice is the, they basically see themselves as the center of the Christian world. Okay, they basically see whatever they believe is the only truth. Okay, and sometimes they even question all these Westerners or maybe overseas Chinese who come to China to preach. They even challenge them. You know, who give you the authority? You know, we were Christian for so many centuries and generation. Yeah. So I think especially when you debate about all this moral issue, I think most of these old Christians were extremely orthodox. Yeah, especially the French Catholics. The Chinese Catholic. They were extremely orthodox on the moral issue. Yeah.
What do you mean orthodox?
Sorry.
What do you mean by orthodox? Orthodox in the sense what we understand orthodox here.
No. I think maybe they're more conservative, you know, on all this moral issue. Yeah.
But they still follow that of the so-called the traditional Chinese literature. The way they see how the world works.
Yeah. And don't forget though, I think there's also another problem when you talk about this old Christian. After 1949, after the Communist Revolution, they were basically they were completely cut off, you know, from the outside world. Not only the missionary, but also, you know, the Chinese outside China. So at least I think from the 1950s up to 1980s, they were basically live in isolation. Okay, and some of them also experienced some, you know, religious persecution as well. So I think to them, they still see, you know, they, because of all this very harsh experience, they do see themselves have, you know, much spiritual authority to tell all this, you know, new missionary or new guy who come to China to lecture us.
Although their interpretation of what Christianity is very different than
what certainly
before,
yeah,
Christianity,
but they would not know.
They will not know.
Can understand, see themselves.
I think they were completely cut off from all this debate that was going on in the West. Yeah. So I think, yeah.
In that sense, if you just look back and say that, the Jewish, the Judaism, that one Jew can say to the other Jew that you're not Jew.
Yeah, you can say that. Yeah, I think that was what happened. In fact, they also tried to. Yeah, when I was in the villages, they always, you know, try to re-educate me or brainwash me, you know, according to their own Christian faith. So it was, there are lots of...
talking about people nowadays, in what age group? Older people?
The older people.
Prior to 1949 or the younger generation?
The people who were living, you know, before, who become Christian before 1949. So those people who are now at the age of 70, 80, 90s, Yeah, so all these elderly people, they basically just tell me, you know, the good old days and then our good Christian faith. You know.
What about the younger generation at the village?
That's a very good question. Now, in the villages, I think like in some other villages across China, most of these young people, they actually went to work in the urban area. So I think in the villages, most of them were basically elderly men and women. There are not many younger people around. But the thing is, when you look at all these, you know, beautiful church buildings, all these young men and young girls, they basically send their money home. And they also ask their overseas Chinese relatives to send their money back to help them to rebuild all these religious institutions.
Overseas or from other part of China?
Both. From other part of China like Canton, Beijing and Shenzhen. And also from overseas Chinese community in Hong Kong and even in United States to send money back to rebuild the churches. Now, there's another difference. When they talk about Christianity here, to them, it is extremely important to have a very big church building. Okay, it's extremely important to have a big church building. So in a way, you can actually see they still operate in a very traditional village mentality. Just like the other, you know, temple organization, they need to have a huge temple. So as a Christian, if you want to be faithful Christians, so to speak, so you need to have a very big church building in the area.
These people would send money back to their own village to rebuild the village. So this is the same idea.
The same practice.
They rebuild the church because it's the same thing.
Exactly.
Identity.
Yeah.
How big a community is it, say, around the time that you were doing your study? You mean, say, around 1860 to 1900? Within, say, Chaozhou, what percentage of the population?
Or the overall population?
Yes.
Well, we don't have the statistic for the late 19th century. I think we can guess maybe, I would say 1 million.
Numbers,
but I think that's my guess, you know, based on my reading of all this taxation record. But they are not always reliable, because when they say a person, sometimes it can mean the family, sometimes it can just mean one individual. So it's very hard to guess, but I would say at least 1 million. Yeah, but certainly when you look at the overall population, I think the Christian only make up a very small percentage. But the thing is, I think in Chaozhou, in certain part of Chaozhou, and especially in this county, I think the Christianity actually, it was a dominant religion. It was a dominant religion. And when I talked to some of the Chinese government officials who were dealing with all these local religious affairs, the people who work at the Bureau of Religious Affairs, they actually tell me, within the entire Guangdong area, Chaozhou have at least 30% of the population are Protestant and 30% of the population are Catholic, and the other 40, they are just everything. Atheists, Buddhists, Taoists. So, but at least in the government figure, they can identify as high as 60%, you know, can be identified as either Catholic or Protestant. So I think within the Chaozhou, this is actually quite a unique area.
So Chaozhou is a unique example that is different from, say, Guangdong as a whole province,
yeah,
or Fujian as a whole province.
Yeah, certainly. And the other thing is, because in Chaozhou, people also speak their own dialect. They do not speak the Cantonese language, they speak the Chaozhou dialect. So in a way, we are talking about a very unique ethnic community here. And so it's quite striking, is, you know, how come Christianity was so successful in this region. And going back to my early argument, basically the Bible and gun connection. If you don't have the power, if you don't have the gun, no one will listen or even look at the Bible. So I think the political incentive was very important.
Now, I have just a question. In terms of, say, comparison between Chaozhou and, say, Fujian and Guangdong, so the local government's authority is probably much stronger in those two neighboring provinces.
Yes, certainly. Yeah, I think that's a very good point. Yeah, certainly. Especially in the Po River Delta. Yeah, around the Canton City, you know, the area around Hong Kong. Yeah.
Chaozhou seems to be a very interesting area in the sense that it has all these immigrants going to
Southeast Asia.
Southeast Asia,
yeah,
you know, to Siam, and using that, so it's a very unique, in some sense.
Situation. In fact, I'm after this study, I'm actually working on the next project, is to look at this kind of Chinese overseas Christian network. One thing I noticed is when I was in China, I actually look at some of the government archives, and the government actually opened up all these documents. And I find it interesting is in 1949, during the period of the land reform, most of these local Baptist Catholics, they actually left the country and they end up in Bangkok, Malaysia, Singapore. They basically went to overseas to rely to live with their overseas relative. So here we can actually see some kind of Christian migration network. And we also see the center of the Christian movement shift from mainland China back to Southeast Asia. Yeah, I think this connection is quite unique. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks.
How many generations away this old Christian from the Taiping Tingguo?
Oh, Taiping Tingguo. Let me see. They were actually around the same time. Yeah, but
just happened in different areas.
Just happened in different areas. In fact, they don't have any. The Taiping Tingguo movement, the Taiping Rebellion, did not affect them at all. I think the Taiping Rebellion remained a Hakka movement. Yeah, Hakka
movement. They were not aware of each other?
They were certainly aware of each other. They were certainly aware. Well, I think that. Well, these people, they were aware of the Taiping movement, but certainly the Taiping just don't care. Yeah, because they were fighting against, you know, in the north. Yeah. But they do not have any initiative to establish contact with the Taiping. I guess because it's just, you know, they're totally different ethnic group or dialect speaking people.
Different motivation too, I suppose.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. Yes.
Well, I just wonder about the validity of the your data, because you read these documents.
Yeah.
Prepared by the church.
Yeah, yeah.
You know how they embellish.
Of course.
Their accomplishment.
Yeah, they all the time.
That you have
yeah.
Listed there, the converted, the number that were of people who were converted. I wonder how valid it is.
Yeah.
Have you checked the?
Yeah, I did.
You know, cross.
Yeah, I did. Oh, thank you very much for your question. Certainly, I think whenever we look at all this church material, we have to be very careful because, like every single institution, I think they always have their own biases. Now, these church figures, especially the Baptist and the Presbyterian, I think for the Presbyterian, I think they're far more reliable because usually they, because when I look at the whole process of baptism, I think the Presbyterian missionary, they do have some centralized mechanism to collect all this local church membership, because every year all these local Presbyterian church have to come to the treaty port and then to report the case to the missionary, and then they start to take down the church members and also their name and their home villages. So apart from the figure, I also got the name and also the villages and sometimes the age and the gender as well. Now for the Baptists, it's a little bit more difficult because each Baptist church is totally independent from one another. I was very fortunate to get this Baptist church material because in the early 1935, there was some kind of celebration within the Baptist church, and they would like to show off their achievement. So what they did is they published all the church membership record. And so that was the most complete church membership record I have up to 1935. And after that, nothing, yeah. And I think within the Baptist Church records, I think they also got the name, the year of birth, and the age, and also the gender, and also the name of their home villages. So I think all this data actually allowed me to study the age structure, gender structure, and also to identify which part of Chaozhou, you know, are they from. Yeah.
What about the local record? Are there a Chinese local government that keeps some kind of a record about
Yeah, yeah. In fact,
even the what you are talking about, the numbers that the church have, the names and the age and birthday date, I don't know how valid it is.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think for the local church record, well, first of all, going back to here, two questions. You know, whether the Chinese government keep the local church record? Yes, they did. I think in the past, people think the Cultural Revolution destroyed everything. But in fact, the Cultural Revolution helped to preserve this church record. Because when I was doing my research in China, I went to all these local government archives. And I looked at their catalog, and they actually allowed me to use their material as well. I was really surprised to find all these local church archives. They basically, all these, you know, the documents owned by some Baptist, Catholic, and Presbyterian church. Most of this material were taken over by the Chinese state during the land reform period. And the state basically just, you know, deposit all this document in the government office. and they did not touch them from the 1950s up to 60s and then 70s. And once they built a government archive system, they put all this material into the archives. So this material were actually not destroyed, and they were extremely well preserved. So I was very fortunate to read some of this material. And in some of this material, they do have some kind of congregational history written by some local church leaders. And when I look at the name of some of the early church members in different local area, and when I compare their name with those unnamed I found in the local church, in the church membership record, I can identify, you know, who's who and also what's their kinship connection. So in a way, I think they're actually quite reliable. Yeah. And surprisingly, all this material is still around.
How is this?
Two more questions.
Oh, go ahead, please.
This so-called three patriotic
a free self patriotic organization.
How relevant is this today?
Okay, yeah, I'm glad that you asked. In fact, I think after 1949, the Chinese government actually create two political organizations in order to control the church, the Catholic and the Protestant church. For the Protestant church, they create what we call a free self patriotic organization. For the Catholic church, also free self Catholic patriotic association. Now, free self means self-propagating. That means you preach the Christianity by the Chinese, for the Chinese. Self-financing, you do not get the money from the missionary. You get all the money from your local church member to run the church. And also self-managing. You manage your own church affairs. You do not allow all these foreigners to run the church for yourself. So they use these two political organizations to take over all the Protestant and Catholic churches from the missionary. And these two organizations remain the official framework that the Chinese state use to deal with the local religious community. They also got the same organization to deal with the Buddhist, Taoists, and well, the Islam, the Muslim. They basically leave them alone. Nowadays, in most of these villages I went to, most of these are basically free self churches. That means they are government church. They are officially recognized by the state. They got the license. They got the license. They got a certificate from the government. So that means they can open their door, and to do the Sunday service. So they are legal institution. Okay, but within the area, I also know there are many so-called underground churches, the house churches. That means those people who do not have the license, who refuse to apply for a certificate from the state, who refuse to have any deal with the government.
Many
reasons. Religious reason, they believe a total separation of church and state. Now, for some of them. The other reason, personality crash. Because some of these house church leaders, they did not get along well with the free self church leaders because of the interests and personalities. Now, in North China, in Beijing and Tianjin, all these northern Chinese cities I went to, there were lots of confrontation between the Chinese state church and this local house church. There were actually, you know, hostile relationship. These two sides never get along. And sometimes the house church even organized some campaign to boycott the official churches. So there were lots of tension there. But in Chaozhou, it's totally different. The picture is totally different. In Chaozhou, then some kind of house church and underground church movement. But the funny thing is, when you look at the leader and the members, they often overlap. Okay, so in the morning, the people worship at the government church, and in the evening, they just have the Bible study within the house church. And in the morning, the government, the minister who preach in the official church, he came to the Bible study in the evening. So there was lots of overlap, and also in the relationship between the two are much more harmonious in Chaozhou than in North China. And I guess for two reasons. One is, the state don't want to, but the local government do not want to get involved in this religious affair, because when you look at all these big churches, it's a good investment. They can get all this overseas donation. So the local government basically just adopt a much more open door policy towards the Christianity and even some other religious group. So the government did not, you know, take and did not really, you know, look at this issue. Yeah.
At that time, when violence happened, was there a local enforcement violence or something? How did it, if there's gunfight, someone died, how did it end? And
we just die.
So there's no police, no government?
No. To be honest, I think the Chinese government actually stopped at the county level. It never go into the village level in the late 19th century. It was actually after the 1949 Communist Revolution that for the first time the Chinese state was able to establish control at the village level. So before that, whenever you have all this kind of violence and fighting, basically the local people trying to, you know, organize some kind of, you know, peace talk or get the other two sides to compromise. If they can't, then they will ask the government to interfere. Basically ask the government to send in the army to control the situation. Now the problem is, you know, from the Lei Qing up to the Republican period, whenever you ask the government to interfere, most of these government officials, they would like to use the occasion to make money for themselves. So basically, you know, they do not come in as a lawmaker. They just come in, you know, trying to be a broker, you know, trying to take advantage of the situation. Yeah. So that's why whenever possible, they would like to stay away from the authority. And maybe for this reason, that's why they turn to all these, you know, foreigners and basically trying to use the foreigners, you know, to deal with the local situation.
One more question?
Yeah, go ahead.
Did you see any incidents of missionaries who were captured by the spirit of where they were and fell into that lifestyle rather than Chinese?
Oh, the missionary were converted to the Chinese tradition. Let me think. Now, based on my reading, no. But I noticed there's one missionary. He's an English Presbyterian. His name is John Gibson. He actually stayed in Chouzhou for 40 years. And he also wrote several books to talk about the local custom and the local religion. From his writing, I think he must be converted to Confucianism and Buddhism. Yeah, and he actually talked about the feng shui in such great details. I was so impressed. Yeah, John Gibson.
I read somewhere that there was at one time a small Jewish population.
Oh yeah,
they totally converted to
Chinese. Yeah, that's the Jews in Kaifeng, the Kaifeng Jews. Yeah, I'm glad that you mentioned that because, in a way, when you look at the Chinese, all this kind of religious culture in China, we are talking about an extremely inclusive culture. Okay, it's not an exclusive culture that you see in the Islamic world or the Christian world. And I think the Jews is a good example. They came in as some kind of religious minority, but later on they basically adopt all these local Chinese practices and then they transform themselves. In fact, I think the same thing is actually happening here. You know, how this local Christian actually trying to integrate their Christian faith into their local religious practices. One example.
Was it the same time?
No, I think the Jews were much. The Jews were much more earlier. I think the Jews were. They came in the Song Dynasty. There was one of that. Yuan. Yeah, I think they came in the Song and Yuan Dynasty around 13th century or something. Yeah, but I think for the local Christian here, they also adopt some of the traditional practice. Whenever I go to the villages. And I saw the church building is always the tallest building, the most imposing building in the area. And I talked to some of the local feng shui master, what do they think of the church? They think, you know, the Christian have a really good taste for feng shui. They always get the best spot of the land. Yeah, so in a way, I think, you know, although they denounce this kind of practice, but actually they were doing that all the time. Yeah.
Wise decision.
Yeah, I don't know, but they seem to be doing quite well still, so, yeah.
I want to thank you for taking the time to give us such an enlightening talk, and I hope that you'll come back and talk to us some more.
Oh, definitely. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.